Subscribe to Blessed Arc for your dose of art, architecture and design. And hit the bell icon so you never miss an update. Anne Lacaton and Jean-Philippe Vassal have been awarded the Pritzker Prize 2021. Now, I know as a young student, the concept of Pritzker Prizes was very, very fascinating to me. And I really wanted to know the life and designs of the architect who received it. So in this video, we are looking at the practice of Anne Lacaton and Jean-Philippe. We will also look at some of their notable works and why they were chosen as the winners of this year's prize. Now before I start, I just wanted to tell you that Blessed Arc is on Patreon, and if you would like to support this channel, you can find the link in the description below. Also, before I start, there's a lot of French names in this video, and I tried my best to Google how to pronounce them, but please, quite literally, pardon my French. Alright, so Anne Lacaton and Jean-Philippe Vassal first met in the late 1970s during their formal architecture training at École Nationale Supérieure des Architectes. This place. Post that, Lacaton went on to pursue a master's in urban planning from Bordeaux Montaigne University, while Vassal relocated to Niger to practice urban planning. Lacaton often visited Vassal in Niger, and they both were profoundly influenced by the beauty and humility of sparing resources within the country's desert landscapes. As Vassal recalls, Niger is one of the poorest countries in the world, and the people are so incredible, so generous, doing nearly everything with nothing, finding resources all the time, but with optimism, full of poetry and inventiveness. It was really a second school of architecture. So together they established Lacaton Vassal in Paris in 1987. For over three decades, they have designed private and social housing, cultural and academic institutions, public space and urban strategies. Now, one of the reasons they've been awarded the Pritzker Prize this year is because the duo's architecture reflects their ideologies of social justice and sustainability. Let's go into some of the works that have been selected by the jury members. The first project we are looking at is the Latapie House, or the Latapie House, I don't know, this is the spelling. The inexpensive house is a result of a commission to build on a low budget, a house for a couple with two children. The house is a simple volume on a rectangular base. On a metal frame, the facade facing the street side is covered with opaque fiber cement sheeting, and on the other side, which faces a huge garden, it is covered with transparent polycarbonate sheeting, forming a greenhouse of sorts. There is also a wooden volume behind these polycarbonate sheetings, and this volume defines an insulated and heated winter space. Since the facade is openable, the house can change from its most closed to its most open state according to the need and desire for light, transparency, intimacy, protection, and ventilation. Hence, the areas where one dwells within the house can also vary from the smallest, which is the living room and the bedrooms, to the largest by integrating the entire garden in high summer. As Lacaton puts it, from very early on, we studied the greenhouses of botanic gardens with their impressive, fragile plants, the beautiful light and transparency, and ability to simply transform the outdoor climate. It is an atmosphere and a feeling, and we were interested in bringing that delicacy to architecture. On a grander scale, Lacaton and Vassal, alongside Frédéric Drouot, transformed La Tour Bois-le-Prêtre. I hope I pronounced that right. It is a 17-story, 96-unit city housing project originally built in the early 1960s. The architects increased the interior square footage of every unit in this building through the removal of the original concrete facade and extended the footprint of the building to form bioclimatic balconies. Once constrained, living rooms now extend into new terraces as flexible space, featuring large windows for unrestricted views of the city, thus reimagining not only the aesthetic of social housing, but also the intention and possibilities of such communities within the urban geography. This framework was similarly applied to the transformation of three buildings consisting of 530 apartments at the Grand Park. The transformation resulted in a dramatic visual reinvention of the social housing complex, the modernization of elevators and plumbing, and the generous expansion of all units, some nearly doubling in size, without the displacement of any residents, and for one-third the cost of demolishing and building new. Next up is their transformation of the Palais de Tokyo, With their restoration, they increased the museum by 20,000 square meters, in part by creating new underground space and assuring that every area of the building is reserved for the user experience. Retreating from the white, cube galleries and guided pathways that basically you can see in many contemporary art museums, the architects instead created voluminous, unfinished spaces. These spaces allow architects and curators to create boundless exhibitions for all mediums of art within a range of physical environments, from dark and cavernous to transparent and sunlit, that encourage visitors to linger. Lakaton insists that transformation is the opportunity of doing more and better with what is already existing. The demolishing is a decision of easiness and short term. It is a waste of many things, a waste of energy, a waste of material, a waste of history. Moreover, it has a very negative social impact. For us, it is an act of violence. Now, I know a lot of students from my generation are used to looking up to star architects and their iconic forms. So some questions might arise as to why Lakaton and Vassal were chosen to receive this prize. Well, for that, let's take a look at the announcement made by the Pritzker Prize. Through the design of private and social housing, cultural and academic institutions, public spaces and urban developments, Lakaton and Vassal re-examine sustainability in their reverence for pre-existing structures, conceiving projects by first taking inventory of what already exists. By prioritizing the enrichment of human life through a lens of generosity and freedom of use, they're able to benefit the individual socially, ecologically, and economically, aiding the evolution of a city. With these words, it is clear that the winner wasn't chosen based on the most iconic or the most flamboyant architecture out there. It was not just about expression. It was based on the analysis of the relationship between the built environment and its users. I think Alejandro Aravena, who was the chair of the Pritzker Prize jury this year, he put it very clearly when he said, "This year, more than ever, we have felt that we are a part of humankind as a whole, be it for health, political or social reasons. There is a need to build a sense of collectiveness. Like in any interconnected system, being fair to the environment, being fair to humanity, is being fair to the next generation." Lakaton and Vassal are radical in their delicacy and bold through their subtleness, balancing a respectful yet straightforward approach to the built environment. And that was it, you guys. So tell me, what are your thoughts about the winners of this year? Let me know in the comments below. If you would like to know or read more about the winners, you can do so from the Pritzker Prize website. The link will be in the description below. As always, don't forget to like this video, to share it, and to subscribe to Blessed Art for more such content.